Hello and welcome to Fast Charge, our weekly podcast here at Tech Advisor. This week, I am your host. It's me, Toddy. Dom is elsewhere. As you might have noticed, what we mentioned at the end of last week, Dom was swanning off to Hawaii, but he's not having a holiday. He is actually doing a lot of work, which we're going to talk about this week. But before we get to what we're going to talk about, I am joined by Hannah and Lewis here helping me run the show. We're going to touch on some news first, and then we're going to talk about everything that has been going on at the Snapdragon Summit, which is what's going on in Hawaii, namely a new chipset that's going to be running pretty much every flagship phone next year, more or less, minus a few notable omissions. Then a very interesting portable games console that is both a Snapdragon or Qualcomm and Razer-based affair. And then we're going to touch on the Honor 60 line, which just launched in China. But speaking of China, let's roll back to some rumors that have happened this week about Huawei, which is a new foldable that the company has maybe been cooking up for, I'm going to say, about 18 months at this point. I'm pretty sure I started writing about it a long time ago. But there has been a new set of developments from, now this is a machine translated username, so I don't know if it's the correct username, but Chrysanthemum Films Fans, that's films with an S on Weibo, shared some information from a company called Zhaoli Technology, and I've probably butchered that pronunciation, who make smartphone hardware. Namely, they've been working apparently on a hinge that is a lot simpler than the kind of hinges we've already seen from the likes of the Huawei's own Mate X range, Samsung's Galaxy Fold and Flip ranges. And this simpler hinge means it's a lot more cost effective and more reliable. That's the theory anyway. And apparently this hinge is ready for mass production. They've actually started mass production, and it's assumed that this hinge is going towards devices that are being made by Huawei. There are a couple of renders in this post as well, which fall in line with some of the early CAD and paint and stuff that we saw on the Mate V or whatever it's going to be called from Huawei a while back. So if you haven't been following along, the Mate V is essentially Huawei's take on Samsung's Galaxy Z Flip line. So instead of a book style foldable, it's a clamshell, which we've not actually had from the company yet. I think, Lewis, you tried the Mate XS.
It was the XS, yeah. I was like,
which had the external folding display and no internal display. And then kind of changed that up with the Mate X2, which Dom reviewed. But those were both still very much Galaxy Z Fold style book foldables. So this is a notable change for Huawei's foldable strategy, something that I think they've been cooking up for a while. So if it does come to market, it'll be great to see, although I have a sneaking suspicion, at least initially, it won't launch outside of China. The rumors do suggest that it's actually going to hit as soon as this December, as in right now. But I doubt that's going to be anywhere other than China. Next up, staying with the foldable thread, we also have some new details on a foldable that Oppo might be working on. This one does appear to be a book-style foldable, and Digital Chat Station, who, if you don't know, has done great work in the world of leaks and mobile technology, has come with a few tidbits of specs about what that device might be bringing to the table. So it sounds like a more modest take on this sort of form factor, namely because it has a 60 hertz external display and then a 120 hertz internal screen. And with that, it has a 32 megapixel centrally positioned hole punch camera on the external screen, and then a corner positioned in the top left corner selfie camera on the main display when you open the thing up. And beyond that, all we really know is that it has a triple camera on the back led by a 50 meg sensor, and the design is going to be kind of like the Oppo Reno 6. So that's all we know right now. That's not a lot to go on. We've heard of Oppo talking about and working on their own foldable for a while, but we've yet to see one actually come to market. We've also seen the Oppo X2021 concept, which was an expanding phone. So they're clearly very interested in new form factors and trying to kind of push form factor technology. But with specs like that 60 hertz screen, it seems more like we're going for maybe a slightly more affordable, I'm hoping, option than maybe the Mate X2.
I'd be happy to see that, right? Because like all the other foldable phones, like, you know, not to be mean or anything, but it's for people who, you know, are looking to splash out. And,
prohibitive.
You know, yeah.
Cost. And
it'd be nice to have something that has that protective sort of thing and is a bit, you know, can offer something different, but people can, not have to worry about dropping like a month of London rent on it.
And London rent as well.
Yeah.
I think we might have touched on it last week in our Black Friday segment, but I think Dom was extremely excited because there were discounts on the Z Flip 3 that meant it was about the same price as a regular flagship phone, which was kind of, that's something.
I mean,
to
even
take
I was
of.
Tempted, and I, you know, I'm diehard iOS, but I was like, you know, for $799, that's not bad at all, is it really?
Well, now you might want to hold fire because there's two potential new options coming from both Huawei and Oppo. I mean, maybe the Huawei one might not be for you without the Android, the Google Play services, but the Oppo one I would totally consider, depending on the price point that they hit. So we'll have to wait and see. We don't have a date or anything on that just yet. Revolving from foldables to Sony, I actually went hands-on with the Sony Xperia Pro I, which is... I'm not going to get too into complaining about names because I feel like I do that every week. But
me
had
too.
A go on
it's always Sony. So
always. But this is, effectively the successor to the Xperia Pro that they launched last year. It is effectively also an Xperia 1 Mark III, their current mainstream flagship, albeit with a 1-inch sensor on the back. So that main 12-meg sensor has been upped, so the physical sensor size is bigger. Supposedly this means you're going to get better quality out of it. You're going to get more realistic image quality, better bokeh, lots of different things. And some of that came across in the hands-on. Also the manual control, the levels of manual control. They've added another app. So they already had, issues with the Xperia 1 Mark III because they'd already split up the stills and video app. And it was a bit confusing because of, I think... stills were also available in the video app in basic mode or something weird like that. I can't remember now, but if you go back and listen to that episode with my Xperia 1 Mark III review, you'll find out. But now they've got the Cinema Pro app, the Photo Pro app, and now the Video Pro app, which is just a different... It's very confusing. That's the main thing I took away from my hands-on, was like, that's really weird. But the actual story this week is that despite them announcing the phone in October and saying it was coming, we now actually have release dates and pricing. So if you're in Europe, I think France got it yesterday as we record this on December 1st, and the European pricing all over the place seems to be consistently 1,799 euros, which is pretty steep, but a lot cheaper than the last Xperia Pro, which I'll mention in a second. In the UK, we get it today. I know, believe it or not, yes. Today we get it December 2nd in the UK. I think it's for £15.99. And then it's coming to Germany for the same European price on December 7th. And then it's coming to the US on December 10th for... let me check my notes about that one. Yeah, same. $17.99. So yeah, it's not an insignificant price tag. It's foldable pricing. It's actually more expensive than... I think a Z Flip 3, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
So yeah, that's pretty crazy. But then, to put it into perspective, the last Xperia Pro, which didn't have a particularly upgraded camera experience over the standard Xperia 1 Mark II that it was basically based on, this one, that one cost £2,299 or $2,499.99. So it's a lot cheaper. So perspective-wise, it's an improvement, right?
There's got to be only a handful of phones that are over $2,000.
Before you get into like the gold-plated, super luxury, silly editions from third parties. Yeah, absolutely. It is a not insignificant amount of money. But
do you remember when phones weren't that expensive, though? Like, just generally. Like, I remember the iPhone used to cost like £600, like, for the top-end iPhone. And I was like, even then, I was like, that's still... a bit much. Now here we are talking about £2,000 phones, and I'm like, no,
just
what
like
is going on?
Soul.
Honestly.
I'm still impressed, though, when at the super budget end, you know, especially now that, like, even feature phones, updating some of our charts recently, even feature phones now, you can get ones with WhatsApp and Google Assistant.
Yeah.
For like £60. Like, that's pretty good. Yeah. That seems all right. So I feel like, yes, it's getting maybe worse at the top end, although you're getting so niche by the level of the Xperia 1, like Xperia Pro I. Like, I think Sony knows that this is a niche product. I hope they do. They seem to. Retailers in the UK,
they're not projecting,
example,
millions of sales, are they?
Yeah, I don't think so. But they've like put the phone on sale, not just... They're even marketing it as a camera first with a phone sort of attached to it. Okay. And it's on sale from Wex, which is a photography retailer in the UK, more so than like a phone brand. I think O2 is the only carrier in the UK that's ranging it, for example. So they kind of understand that this is a pretty specific kind of device.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to think. I mean, I know I'm not a camera person myself, but I'm gathering that, you know, even photographers, you would be paying maybe more, I'm assuming, for like a DSR and all that sort of thing.
Yeah, I mean, my dalliance is with proper photography. It's really the lenses where your money goes. You can get a good body for under a grand, but then you could spend well over a grand on some nice lenses. So that's really... It was something Sony actually tried a while back. They had these like Bluetooth connected external lenses.
I loved that idea.
I really liked those, but they could have done so much more. They should have done a lens mount so you could put on their alpha camera lenses, but I don't think the two were around at the same time.
That would have been
Sony, take note.
I mean, it's just a note for everyone to take note of. I don't know why people haven't thought of this yet. But...
Like one of my favorite phones from yesteryear was that Samsung Galaxy S3, I think it was, the S3 Zoom, where it was basically a digital camera, where it had the 10 times optical zoom, where it actually popped out like a digital camera. Like, that
They've
is
actually tried
still
that
one
a
of my
few
favorites.
Times. Yeah, they had a, I think before they used the Galaxy name, they had a phone, it might not have even run Android, that was also effectively, it just looked like a combat camera. They had the S4 Zoom, and they had the K Zoom as well, which I can't remember if that came before or after, but... They were all basically just like,
let's
when
go
you
back
went
to
on
that
out with
and
a
you had like
camera
the,
rather than your phone as your main camera. That was the perfect kind of melding of those two
literally.
Things.
Even that, and you know, these Sony Ericsson CyberShot phones, like they had such a focus on these back in the
Sony
day.
Sony Ericsson.
Throwback.
I know. All the nostalgia today.
I think our demographic is around for, I don't think our demographic is so young that they won't remember any of these things.
No,
so
I'm hoping
I
not.
That's okay to mention.
Yeah, don't make us feel old, please.
Yeah, I was about to say, I don't think I'm that old, please.
I remember when the T60AI, which was like one of Sony Ericsson's first color screen phones, you could buy a separate plug-in camera that you'd snap on the bottom.
Oh, nice.
No,
and it was like, took like photos the size of my thumbnail sort of level of quality, but
so the game
it worked
right,
and that was amazing. And I have one other Sony story to talk to you, and then we'll talk about other news that happened this week, which is that a new patent cropped up which showed what effectively amounted to a DualShock 4, as in not a DualSense, a DualShock 4 controller that's been chopped in half and stuck on either end of a smartphone. And this is actually a patent that Sony Interactive Entertainment Japan apparently published this week. It was picked up by Video Game Chronicle. And apparently one of the things that isn't in the picture is it also has some sort of protrusion that allows for tilt controls as well. So kind of like six-axis functionality. And it's obviously thought to be for PlayStation games via remote play or cloud gaming, maybe through third parties like Stadia and Xbox. Was it Xbox Game Pass Ultimate? That's the correct phrase, Lewis. Is that right?
That's the subscription. Yeah, but then you've got Xbox Cloud Gaming, which is a separate thing that's also included within the pass.
Right.
Yes, it's all very confusing.
And I know, Lewis, when I showed this first to you, you were a bit hesitant because it's just another patent in a
this
sea
is what
of
I
patents.
Mean.
And
yeah. My thing is, like, because I cover it's more on the iPhone side of things, but I've seen so many iPhone and iPad and Apple Watch patents over the years, and not a single one of them has actually ended up in a phone or an Apple Watch or an iPad. So I love the idea of actually having a DualShock 4 iPhone controller, because that is the problem with the DualShock at the moment, is that you can't connect your phone to it, so it's just awkward. And that's where kind of the third parties come in and clean up. So for Sony to have something official with, you know, the square, circle, triangle, you know, the actual Sony branding, it would just kind of complete the experience. But yeah, just based on a patent, I'm skeptical.
My kind of hesitance about this is not that it's not legitimate, but I was more just curious as to why they decided now was the time, especially since they've pushed remote play as an option already on Android devices. I think most Android phones recently can get the remote play app and you can stream games from your PlayStation to your phone. They already sell a mount for an existing DualShock 4 controller, like an official one with a suction cup that you just stick your phone on. This is more elegant, I imagine. It's kind of more like the Backbone One or the Razer. Is it the Razer Kishi? Is that the name there?
Yes.
Their mobile controller that snaps on the edge. You know what I mean? It's like two halves that snap on the edge, and that's exactly what this patent, this prototype kind of points to.
I mean,
they already have a solution.
Is it like intuitive to use like these sorts of things? Are they actually like good in practice? Because it seems to me like it'd just be very, very awkward and bulky, and I'd be worried about dropping things. And you know, like whenever I use, I don't know. Maybe it's just me, but
I think
I think that's a totally fair question. from I think it's very much hit and miss. I would say there's factors like the size of your device to begin with.
Yeah.
How much wider you're making it.
I've got two phones here as an example.
Right. So the one in your, I think, left hand, if this is the right way around, like that's a hefty device, right?
Yeah.
I saw one of those for the 12.9-inch iPad Pro once, and I was like, that is too much. Like, it was literally like this with a massive strap. You're like, yep, this is the perfect
gaming device.
You just
may as well have a TV at that point.
You might as well.
Maybe just stay home. Just stay home and play on your TV. It's fine.
Literally.
So I think, the painting as well, the sizing of the device, the aspect ratio, it does look like a Sony device because it has what appears to be a 21:9 aspect ratio, which not most other phones don't really go for because it's so long and thin. But I think it has potential. I totally see it being a product that would exist. I don't think it's a bad idea for Sony to do it. It just seems odd to me. But it was also, Sony has tried and failed like a bajillion times to get into or break into the mobile gaming space.
What was it called?
The Xperia Play. That was one of the things, which was like a sliding Android phone that had capacitive thumbsticks and then a D-pad, I remember that one. The buttons. Yeah, that was a weird one.
That was horrible.
But as part of this story, they've also kind of, there are other signs that they are really genuinely gearing up this time, which is what I think gives more weight to this patent leak or patent publication. I'm not sure if it was a leak or not. They recently appointed in October the Apple Arcade content boss, Nicola Sebastiani, so former Apple Arcade kind of lead person, is now heading up Sony's mobile operations with regards to mobile gaming, which is interesting. And then in November, the PlayStation boss, Jim Ryan, said that they are bringing iconic IP to mobile within this business year, which is any time from, well, now up until March 2022. And then we've also had word that a Wipeout game, if you know Wipeout, the kind of futuristic racing game that I think was on the PlayStation 1, they're bringing a kind of like a Nintendo mobile style approach. So it's a card-based racer is the quote that I read, which I thought was a very interesting way to pitch it, with a bunch of ships from the original games called Wipeout Rush for iOS and Android in early 2022. So like all signs point to this holding water. But it is such an early patenty thing that until we see something more tangible,
I want to see 3D renders or something like that. And I'm like, okay, there's been a little bit more work here.
Yeah. But there's other parts moving within Sony's business that suggest they are genuinely being serious about mobile again. And this is just another kind of piece of that puzzle that I think is quite interesting.
I'm just hoping that they just go all in with the subscription and the cloud and all of it. And they're just like, here's the thing, you know, we've got this amazing cloud service now because they've got PlayStation now, so they've got the infrastructure. They just need good games. They cannot compete with Game Pass Ultimate. Like it's crazy how much better it is, and it makes me sad that there's not one on the PlayStation. But there we are. So yeah, hopefully, because I mean, PlayStation gamers are very vocal when it comes to this kind of thing. Surprisingly, you know, people are actually quite passionate about this kind of thing. Crazily enough. So there's mounting pressure from fans. They're like, look, this is what everyone's getting, and the PlayStation Plus games of the month seem rubbish at the moment. So hopefully 2022 will be a good year for kind of Sony and the PlayStation brand, but we'll see.
Fingers crossed. Right, that is all the news I wanted to talk about. Now let's get on to the main event, which, Snapdragon Summit is the big talking point this week. I think since November 30th, I think, is when Dom landed, or they kicked the event off. But yeah, Dom's over in Hawaii. He is running around the island, checking out silicon, checking out developmental hardware, and he's been writing it all up. So you can check it out all on the site right now, techadvisor.com. But we have a couple of important things to talk about from that. First and foremost is the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1, which we did touch on, I think, last week, because we were talking about, Lewis and I were there talking about the Dimensity 9000, which is MediaTek's new forthcoming flagship chip. One of the first chips built on a 4-nanometer process, and guess what? So is the 8 Gen 1, as we kind of predicted. Beyond the name, which we already knew about before they announced the chip, I'll just run through some of the kind of more mundane but maybe important aspects of what this actually brings to the table. So it's using a new ARM V9 architecture. It has a Cortex X chip like the Snapdragon 888 and 888 Plus, but this is an X2 prime core. So the kind of main, most powerful core running the show. It's clocked at 2.995 gigahertz. So it's a little bit of a slower clock then the Dimensity 9000's main core. Then there's a 3 Cortex A710 performance cores clocked at 2.5 gigahertz and 4 Cortex A510 efficiency cores clocked at 1.8 gigahertz. Qualcomm says this means 20% more power efficiency, 20% more power and 30% more efficiency from the CPU. The GPU also gets a bump, so that's 30% more power and 25% better power efficiency. So all of that is kind of, you know, obvious expected upgrades. Some of the early leaked scores that we saw from test hardware were suggesting that it was obviously better than the 888, but not maybe by as much as some will have hoped. So we'll have to see it in actual hardware, consumer ready hardware, to kind of really tell how much of a jump this is bringing to the table. The name might sound fresh, but maybe the underlying process at work doesn't maybe reflect quite as big a leap as some people might expect.
Well, this is the thing, is like, I think the name is going to be a big like marketing tactic to be able to bump the price up of like phones. But then when you actually like put them side by side, there may not be a massive difference, or the differences may not be like, you know, if you tested them, you wouldn't necessarily be able to see. I mean, I'm just assuming here, like just based on what we've seen, but like, yeah, it will be interesting to see like how much that changes.
I mean, something we never really get insight on how much manufacturers have to pay per chip to put in a phone, but it was famously reported, I think 2 years ago now, the 865 generation, Snapdragon 865 flagship chip, was very expensive, and that's why we got so many phones with the Snapdragon, was it the 765G that went into the Pixel 5 and a bunch of other phones, because it was a really good price performance balance. It was like a high-end mid-range chip with 5G that just, there weren't many of those, and that was the chip that so many brands ended up putting in their flagship phones because the 865 was so pricey. I kind of hope, you know, based on this branding, what you're saying is very potentially real, is that, you know, they'll use it as a kind of springboard to put up a high price again and be like, look at this new chip. But based on those initial benchmarking scores, the advancement over the 888 performance-wise isn't as great as maybe people might expect. So, yeah.
And Qualcomm's got more competition this year as well from Mediatek with the Dimensity 9000.
That Dimensity looks like a legitimate, serious competitor, which I've never really thought of Mediatek in that way. No. But yeah, this year it looks like serious. So yeah,
been
could be good.
Doing their research, haven't they?
Yeah, biding their time, waiting, and now they're ready to pounce. A few other things that it can supposedly sport is up to 144Hz on displays at QHD plus resolution. MediaTek said something similar, but they didn't use the same metric. So their chip promises 180Hz up to, but at full HD plus resolution. So it's hard to compare if you're kind of wanting to know just how the two kind of sit side by side. There's a new 7th gen AI engine with 4x AI performance. Interesting one was a new ISP, an image signal processor, which, you know, they usually use for just camera stuff, like obvious camera stuff. And it has one of those as well for 8K video recording in HDR is possible, bokeh in 4K video is possible, 4 extra stops of dynamic range. But this extra little ISP is also there for always on functionality, which I don't think I'm aware of in a chip, having an always on ISP before. So that seemed interesting to me. So for things like face unlock, but I was also wondering if it would have like instant object recognition for translation or AI tasks and things like that. So you didn't maybe have to open an app or something. I thought there was real potential in that, even though it's a little thing in the chip. I thought it was quite interesting. And then we have a new X65 modem. So just faster speeds, both up and down, I think up to 3.5 gigabits per second up, which is pretty amazing across both millimeter wave and sub six support. And then we have a bunch of devices that are already confirmed to be running on this chip, which is
the most exciting
my favorite
part,
thing
isn't
is
it?
For all the companies just scrambling to be like, we're gonna have it.
6th of December. Well, I'm coming out on the 5th. Well, I'm doing mine on the 4th.
Just as with last year, I think, with the 888, I think Xiaomi is first to the table. The Xiaomi 12, which is their expected next flagship, is going to be available soon. So they haven't said when exactly, but all thoughts are it's before the year's end.
Well, apparently Motorola's claimed that it's coming even sooner, haven't they?
Yeah, Motorola's trying to sneak in there with the Moto Edge X30. So a very confusing new name in the Edge range. I don't want to get into that right now. But yes, they also have a phone. And when's that coming, Lewis?
That's coming on the 9th of December. So that's literally next week. That's a week away.
So that would be, yeah, crazy soon. It's almost like these manufacturers have known about this chip for a while.
If they're imagine
already
that.
Having it in phones that are ready.
You mean they've not just found out like us?
Yeah.
Preposterous.
Yeah.
I always thought you could just plug a CPU into a phone, you know, just there you go, installed. That's all you have to do.
Easy yeah, stuff. Well, I think that's the idea behind like the Fairphone and stuff like that, although I've never really seen them quite achieve that level of flexibility.
No, that would be
one
very
day,
good.
We'll get there.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it looks like Motorola and Xiaomi are the only brands that are going to be having products on store shelves with the 8 Gen 1. Oh, it's not, it doesn't roll off
it's
the tongue.
It's not going to be good, yeah.
this side of the new year. And that also probably means they'll both be China exclusive for the time being. I'm pretty sure last year the Xiaomi 11 or then the Mi 11 didn't hit international waters until the new year. So if you are excited for this new Qualcomm chip, you might have to wait a little bit longer if you're not in China. Speaking of waiting a little bit longer, if you are fans of other brands, Oppo's already been like, yeah, we're going to have a phone in the first quarter of 2021. Realme as well, which makes sense because Realme and Oppo are basically one and the same. The yep. GT2 Pro, their new first ever premium flagship. Which is, I think, pretty much a huge disservice to all of their previous efforts in terms of the high end. That is also coming in the first half of 2022. And then we've had Black Shark, Honor, IQ, Nubia, OnePlus, Redmi, which is obviously Xiaomi again, Sharp, Sony, Vivo, and ZTE have all also said they're going to be having a phones with an 8 Gen 1. So basically everyone minus Apple, which makes sense, and Google. Which makes sense because they've moved to Tensor, which we talked about before. Mm. The only other thing, the only other big omission there really for me was Samsung.
Yeah.
And the strangest thing is this is built on a 4-nanometer Samsung designed process. So this chip is made effectively using Samsung tech, but Samsung wasn't part of that roster. The caveat to that, if you will, is that they weren't on the roster last year either for the 888, but they did have that chip in a phone eventually. So
they just like to be dramatic.
Yeah, you know, they just want like
they
know, just
they don't want to pay for the branding. They're like, we don't need to tease, okay? We're gonna have the phone. It's when coming.
When I first heard it that Samsung wasn't in that initial list, I was like, well, we talked last week about the fact that the MediaTek chip is now apparently going to feature in a high-end Samsung phone. So have they ditched Qualcomm? Oh. But then the signs, it's too crazy.
That's
it would be too crazy.
Yeah, that's too much.
At what point do you think Samsung will do, and do you think they'll ever do like an Apple or a Google and move away?
I mean, they've always kind of dabbled with it by having their Exynos range, but they've never committed fully. And it really, no. I presume there's some sort of licensing or something that means they have to have Qualcomm chips in certain markets, like America.
It's one of those kind of really old backroom deals, like where Microsoft has to sell Duracell batteries with the Xbox controller because of this one deal.
Is that
deal.
A thing?
Is that a thing?
That's a thing, yeah.
Aww. Oh my goodness.
Never knew
that's
that.
It's crazy, I didn't know.
Yeah.
So we don't know officially that Samsung is going to be offering a phone with this chip, but as they're the ones who help make it in a roundabout way, I would be very surprised if they didn't. That would be a very strange move indeed. So yeah, assume that there will also be a Samsung phone running on an 8 Gen 1 at some point in the next year.
Probably the S22, I'm gathering.
Would make sense, wouldn't it? Yeah, which we're expecting in the first few months of the new year. Although I think rumors were that it could even be moved up even sooner.
Who knows with this phone anymore? The whole, you know, the S21 FE, the S22, all of it. They're just, I don't think even Samsung knows at this point.
At this point, fair. And then, a couple of other rumor devices that weren't actually mentioned by name, but, you know, Redmi was on that list. The Redmi K50 is the device that's expected to have this chip. And Asus wasn't on the list, but the ROG Phone 6 makes sense as well, being a high-end chip.
Sure.
And Asus always, like, throws in the top chip from Qualcomm.
Yeah, there is no way that's not happening.
What's that?
I said there is no way that is not happening. They'll
no,
put that
sure,
in there with
sure.
about 25 gig of RAM and be like, yep, call it a day.
Done, my job is done. So that is effectively everything I think fundamentally that you need to know about the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1. That's going to be the chip that's probably going to power your next flagship Android phone, so get excited, I guess. And if you want to know more details, Dom has already got a full write-up, two different perspectives on both the manufacturers and the devices that they are cooking up running on this chip and the chip itself, which you can check out on the website right
now. We're working him very hard.
He's it's frustratingly, he is justifying him being there beyond just sitting sipping cocktails. So I can't be mad at him because he's done a bunch of great work.
This is the problem.
But Qualcomm, yes, they didn't just stop with a smartphone chip. They've already shown off a whole host of other bits of silicon, including some new 5G capable chips for laptops, PCs, and Chromebooks in the 8CX Gen 3 and the 8C Plus, 7C Plus. I mean, I'm not going to touch it about the names.
In the same thing. Yeah.
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 Okay. But yeah. But then they also talked about the Snapdragon G3x Gen 1. I'm going to be doing a test at the end, and you're going to have to, from memory, recite the different chip names, and we're going to see how we do. But yeah, the Snapdragon G3x Gen 1, which they didn't go into as anywhere near as much detail as they did about the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1, but it's assumed to be running on a very similar architecture, presumably with a greater focus on gaming and graphical performance. And the way they were showing that off, or are currently showing it off, at the Snapdragon Summit is by showing off a developmental handheld gaming console that they built in partnership with Razer, which is pretty cool. I mean, you guys have seen the images. It kind of looks like maybe an Xbox controller that they've literally sawn in half, kind of like the patent that we were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
But yeah, what do you guys think based on the initial images and stuff?
When I first saw the images, I was like, this is ugly. I don't like this. Like, I was like, no, this.
But it's
just
developmental hardware, so that's okay.
Exactly. And then I think the bigger thing was kind of reading Dom's hands on. I was like, actually, this doesn't sound bad. It just depends on how they market it on anything. If this is kind of like your go to for cloud gaming and you know, just remote gaming, that's fine. But then why would you need such a high end chipset on it? Because you don't need that if you're cloud gaming.
We should say, I guess, that it. At the event, it's running Android games, just like games you'd have to download from the Play Store. But the concept is that you can also, you know, of course, jump on Stadia or jump on Xbox Game Pass Ultimate or, I guess, PlayStation.
You got Remote Play locally.
Remote Play, that's the one. any other game streaming services I've forgotten about right now?
I think that's about it. Yeah, GeForce Now,
and I guess PlayStation Steam
Now.
As well.
Yeah, you've got the local things like that. And I think there's one, Shadow. Is another one. I don't know how optimized that is for that kind of thing. But yeah, this is the problem because if it's just designed for Android games, then that's boring. Like, I'm sorry, but like, and mobile, you know, Android mobile games are good because, you know, they give you something to do. But like, I'm not going to buy a dedicated device to play mobile games when I can literally already do that on my mobile. I need something different to kind of take
me
with this
hardware. Yeah, I guess. This would make a lot of sense for like the most avid Genshin Impact players because you can play that on Android or you can play that on like I think the Switch has a version. So
well, this is the thing: you can play it on the Switch, and it's like the Switch is in probably I'm assuming infinitely a better handheld experience for these sorts of things. So it's like
I mean, I would jump to say yes, but then I thought about it when I first had that thought, and I was like, well, that's running on a tweaked version of NVIDIA's Tegra X1 chip from several years ago now. I mean, the console came out in 2017, right? And even the new OLED model is still running on that same silicon. So a lot has changed in that time. And for a mobile device, architecture like that, like what's in the 8 Gen 1 and the G3X Gen 1, I'm going to trip up on those names at some point. Is arguably have to be more advanced by this point.
That's true. I think the article mentioned something about battery life, which was like, you know, Switch battery life, you know, not to be mean, but it's not that good.
Rubbish.
I'm there playing Animal Crossing. It's like battery low. And it's like, I picked you up for 20 minutes ago. What are you talking about?
This Razer console, let's call it a console for now, has, I think it's a full HD 120 hertz OLED panel, but the chip, like the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1, can support 144 FPS or hertz, 10-bit color depth HDR, so it can do some really impressive visual stuff. It's also got a 5G modem. I presume it's the X65, as in the 8 Gen 1, which obviously, you know, imagine a Switch with cellular connectivity, like good cellular connectivity. That would be kind of cool.
Yeah, this is kind of why I'm excited for it for cloud gaming, because I'm like, that's where I think it will do well. Because, you know, the Switch-esque form factor with dedicated fast 5G, that's where I see it.
Yeah, I also kind of wanted the Steam Deck to have cellular, and I don't think it does. Correct me if I'm wrong. But between them, like this makeup definitely has a niche. Yes, I know you can use your phone already with a controller like we've talked about with Sony, like we've seen with, you know, the gaming mounts you can just get for your existing gaming controller. But having dedicated hardware from a company that is all about mobile chips, like that just seemed really like a really interesting recipe for me.
Mm-hmm. It's also got like a different audience in the sense that, you know, like there'll be people who love Xbox or PlayStation but don't have that sort of experience to be able to have handheld, which Nintendo already covers. So it's like, you know, obviously it's probably never going to compete in the same way that the main consoles do, but it's going to have an audience that could pick up. And I'm excited to see like other people, like the Steam Deck, things that are entering the space and shaking things up a little bit. It's always nice because you get the same things over and over again every few years. So
yeah,
I mean, you know, like how you compare like a tablet rather than a phone with a plan from your carrier if it's got a modem in it. I could totally see this coming with like a 5G phone plan or cellular plan, I should say, and 6 months of Xbox Game Pass Ultimate and Google Stadia. Like if they threw all the cloud services at it as well, and that's the package that you buy, this suddenly feels like makes a lot more sense. And I think if you get that intent across as to what this device is meant for, beyond just playing Android games like at home, then I feel like it has a lot more legs. Obviously, this is not a product right now that is going on sale. This is developmental hardware just showing off the Snapdragon G3x Gen 1. But Lewis, you did point out it's not the prettiest. It could be massaged, I think, without too much effort into a consumer-ready product looking at it now.
Yeah, according to Dom's hands-on, he said it was pretty polished hardware, even if it's a dev kit. And they are selling the dev kits at Razer. So they wouldn't be selling the dev kits if they didn't have plans to do something with it, at least. Yeah. I just want to say, though, things like this really make you see how far ahead Sony was with the Vita. Like, the PS Vita was a beautiful bit of kit. Like, even compared to this now, like, that is ugly compared to the Vita, in my opinion.
I mean, why did they not... Was it just poor sales?
Yeah, I think it was it was a combination of just... It wasn't selling properly. People weren't really developing the big games for the platform that they wanted to at the time. But I think now, you know, with cloud gaming and these improvements in chipset and stuff like that, they would smash it with the Vita. I would love to have a Vita, like a modern Vita.
And I think if anything, like the Switch has proven that like handheld gaming, it's not like it's not going anywhere. Like people still want it like actively, like you know. So it's like
It's definitely not a niche. And I think it was it was a weird little the weird little CD things to kind of put in them. It was just a bit of a
The CDs. Yeah.
UMDs.
Yeah, it was something weird format? Like that. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Sony loves a weird proprietary format, but like it was cool. But yeah, the Vita, like a lot of Sony, I feel like Sony, it does learn from its mistakes, but also sometimes it kind of doesn't. And in this space, it's always really good at pushing some of the most powerful hardware versus its competitors, and then just not having the library to back it up.
Yeah.
And on PlayStation, the console, the home console, I think they fixed that now because they have so many really good exclusives with like God of War and Horizon and all that stuff. I don't think they ever quite made that recipe work with the PSP and the PS Vita.
Mm.
And obviously like it's gotten better since then because I think they've understood that and they're learning from that. But like the hardware was just very expensive and ahead of its time, like you said, Lewis.
Yeah.
But the games weren't there to back it up.
No, he had one Uncharted game that came out for it, which ran phenomenally, by the way, I will say. There was an Uncharted game for the Vita. I did not realize that. And
I just knew there was like a Metal Gear Solid one that like you could put a weird 3D viewer over the screen and stuff.
Oh, I did not play that one.
Trippy.
That sounds worse.
But yeah, no, the Vita was an incredible device. But yeah, just not meant for this world when it came out.
It's bad. But yeah, I mean, I can't see Razer if something like this does come to market. I can't see them pricing it more than a couple of £100 though, if they want it to compete. Like, how much are we really looking at for something like this? When bear in mind, you do have the Switch Lite, which is basically that exact form factor for £199.
Yeah, true.
But it'd be different audio. It'd be different games and stuff like that, wouldn't it? It'd be completely different.
Arguably worse games because they're all Android based.
Yeah, exactly. If they're all Android based, this is the thing. I can't really understand why would you do it? I don't
If I was going to get this, I wouldn't get it for Android games. I'd get it for the streaming and as just a good streaming device.
100%.
But the screen sounds a bit small to me, I think. for like if you're streaming console style games or PC games with a PC style UI.
That was always my complaint about the Switch with Witcher 3, because I think Witcher 3 was just designed for like the big screen. So like when I kind of played it on the portable, I was just like, this is just too small for me. And I kind of get that because when I do play remote play on my phone, some of the elements from my PS5, I'm kind of like, what is that? You're trying to make out enemies in distance, and they're just dots on a screen. Yeah, you can't see
exactly.
It. So I do think you do need a certain size for these handhelds to really make them effective. I think with the Switch does well because it doesn't really have a lot of those kind of FPS kind of games. So like those split second reaction times don't matter as much.
Games that are designed with the hybrid thing in mind, and that's what makes it so unique. Whereas like games that are for the flagship consoles, they're designed for, you know, it's like, look at this,
exactly.
Packing in the most
Exactly. They're designed for 50-inch TVs.
So do you think this approach was maybe the wrong approach, and they should have done something that is more true to a Switch competitor in that it docks and does a big screen experience as well? Would that have helped?
I think it'd just get criticized then, wouldn't it? Just being like, look at this Switch. It'd just be headlined Switch knockoff from,
wasn't,
you know,
the Razer Switch. Alienware do something like that? Like, that was a bit clunky and horrible, but I'm sure we have a piece on it somewhere. So do we like, or where do we fall?
I'm hesitant.
I need to see more about the game.
This is it. You need to see, because this is what makes any hardware. Like, it doesn't really, I mean, the hardware matters to a certain extent, but it's the games, it's the things you can do on it. Like, it's the same with the Huawei's. You know, Huawei has exceptional hardware in every respect, but without the apps on it, you're not going to buy one. Huawei, by the way.
No, but it's true. Like, you know, you can barely, if you try and use it without Google, I've tried, it's
the headache.
Nay, impossible. Well, not impossible, but, you know, it's just not a good user experience, and that's the same. You wouldn't, it's no good buying a PlayStation 5 if you don't like any of the games on there.
I mean, I did buy my PS4 Pro for one specific game, and then I subsequently found other games that I enjoyed, but that was a bit of a gamble.
I'm doing that with an Xbox. I need to buy an Xbox just for Starfield. Like, I cannot let this game slip me by. And I hate the fact that I'm going to have to get an Xbox.
Elder Scrolls 6 will come in 40 years, don't worry.
I know, that'll be the next one to justify.
That'll be on every platform under the sun, though, so you don't have to worry. It'll be on your, like, smart sofa by the end of the...
Can it run Elder Scrolls 6?
But that'll be Skyrim first, and then...
Yeah, true, true. Skyrim will come back again, in 8 other guises, for sure. As you mentioned, Huawei, that is, I think, a really good jumping off point. We're going to leave Qualcomm behind, as wonderful as they've been this week, and there is more, like I said, to read on the site about them. But former bedfellow and kind of sub-brand of Huawei, Honor, has just launched its new... I'll call them flagships because that's the best phones they do, but they are basically more premium mid-ranges, is probably the better, more accurate description, in the Honor 60 series. Now, this was a launch on December 1st. It was a China-only launch, so we don't yet know whether any of the devices announced are coming to markets outside of China. We have the Honor 60 and the Honor 60 Pro. And they look very nice. First and foremost, they have a sparkly new back finish, which is, I think, arguably one of the biggest selling points.
Yeah, they've always done well, even with their like budget phones, of making them look like very pretty.
Iconic, very distinct, pretty. Which is important, I think. I still miss that Lumia design language with the fluorescent backs, man. That was really good. Industrial design, in my opinion. But yeah, they've got these nice sparkly backs. They look like the predecessors, the Honor 50s, which only launched, I think, earlier this year, so not even a whole year ago, and they have that same, I think, twin reflex inspired camera design, so like the old kind of accordion style cameras of old. It looks sort of like that is what they're going for, but it's these basically two parallel circles on the back. But unlike the quad camera setup on the Honor 50 series, the 60 actually puts two big sensors in those two circles, which makes a lot more sense, and I think it looks a lot nicer as well from like a physical design standpoint too. The Pro is the big one in terms of upgrades. The main sensor on both is 108 megapixel, just as it was, same aperture, same pixel size as on the Honor 50. But then I think it's a 50 megapixel wide angle on the Pro model as that secondary sensor, whereas I think the regular Honor 60 has an 8 meg sensor.
Oh God, that's a massive,
one. Pretty significant difference. It's odd actually, like, initially I was just comparing the two phones, but the more I read, also they are I mean, especially the Honor 60 and the Honor 50, they are weirdly similar. I think you get a bigger battery is really the main hook. 4,800 across both 60 variants, whereas I think it was like 4,500 and then 4,000 in the 50 Pro, which didn't launch outside of China, if I'm not mistaken.
So I have a theory, right, that a lot of mobile providers, they just create a base version so that they can make the Pro version look better.
They
don't really expect to make much of a return on it, but they're just like, oh, here's the base version, you know, like whatever.
Yeah.
But hey, look at the Pro version.
Look at this version. This is what you want.
It does annoy me. I'm not going to lie, but you know.
I mean, I feel that that's marketing. That's like a classic marketing tactic for sure.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think I'd get the Pro only because it seems to have the most meaningful upgrades, but even those are pretty minor. I mean, both phones are bigger than their predecessors. It's a 6.67-inch Full HD 120 Hertz OLED panel, or a 6.78-inch. So they're pretty big. They're not massive, but the Pro is getting towards the same sort of screen size as a Galaxy Note 20 Ultra, for reference, which I think was 6.9. The only other real hook, though, is the 778G Plus, which is a kind of overclocked version of the 778G that's already in both the Honor 50 phones and the Honor 60. So it's pretty incremental stuff, to the point where I'd question why Honor felt the need to push this phone and not instead focus on a new flagship. Still waiting on the Magic 3 series, which they said was launching internationally, but we still don't have it, so...
Was there a massive gap with the Honor 50 in it launching in China and then launching internationally?
Yeah, several months. I think it was March. Don't quote me, but it was like March or sometime in China. And then we got it. I mean, Dom reviewed it at the end of November.
Yeah, I just remember like us talking about being like, when the heck is this Honor 50 coming? Yeah. Like, because it just like didn't quite. I know it might have been like shipping delays or whatever, but yeah, it's like one of those things of like, even though it's been announced, it could be like ages.
Yeah. And the hook of these devices, as with the Honor 50 range, but they're kind of just doubling down, is vlogging is the whole kind of focus. So this jumps from Magic UI 4.2 to 5, atop Android 11. And the main upgrade seems to be just like the vlogging mode that we already saw in both actually the Nova 9 that Huawei launched and the Honor 50, which is a bit awkward, even though they're slightly different visually. They've just kind of given you more AI functionality. There's a whole host of gesture controls now, so you can flip the cameras around and start recording or just using your hands, which is pretty cool. Yeah, I don't dislike that as a feature, yeah. But I don't know if that's enough to warrant. I feel like you'd be pretty miffed if you bought an Honor 50 within the last year, and this is just, you know, incremental but little improvements. Yeah,
But with the same
chip, you could also just maybe software update.
I was going to say, surely you can't just roll this out.
Yeah,
like
they can.
Actually,
they won't.
The same chip.
Because then they will sell none of them. Yeah. No, I've put an image of the rear of the 60 Pro up on the street.
Yeah.
And it looks so much nicer in real life, because initially I just had the official render, but this looks like an actual photo of a hands-on event. And that sparkly rear just looks really...
It does look nice.
Really
like,
nice.
Yeah, it's a bit crazy looking, a bit garish, but I would enjoy
Yeah, it's like
it.
The kind of like a whitey orangish copper. I'm not quite sure what the color is. That looks so good.
Like, yeah, it's just nice to see something that is like not afraid to do something that's a bit bold and, you know, and Honor's, like I said, always been good at that.
And I think like some companies do forget that you do still need the wow factor with these phones. And, you know, it just makes the experience a little bit more when you open a box and you're like, wow, like this is actually, you know, the build quality is really nice. It's kind of like what the watch I've got at the moment. Like, it's just nice build quality. Like, it's just, it goes a long way for
you
this
do
kind
notice
of thing.
It.
Like, exactly.
Yeah, there'll be people who are shopping online and then they'll, you know, they will just look, you know, straight away more at the design more than anything. And then like, you know, a lot of the internals are a bunch of numbers.
Yeah,
exactly. Sure. Yeah, I think we forget in this tech bubble that we're so focused and they're like, well, the incremental battery updates, incremental processor updates, but to the average person, they're like, well, it looks a lot better, so...
Yeah, I mean, I'm even thinking about myself, you know, I'll look at something and I'm like, but that is a nice colour. Like, you know, I will take that.
I guess the design is actually probably one of the bigger upgrades here, especially on the Pro. They both have curved edge displays, but the Pro's display curves at the top and bottom as well. And also they've really, by the looks of it, shrunk down the bezels to, I mean, the initial like teaser renders were a bit misleading because the screen just goes right to the metal frame around the edge, which is not actually how it is in real life, as I checked on the photos,
it's
but
not.
They're not the only company guilty of doing that sort of thing in their images. But yeah, the bezels on the Pro look really thin, which with that curved display, which is I think 88 degrees, which is really, that's a pretty heavy duty curve.
Yeah,
it looks really, really nice. Very premium. So even though it is a premium mid-ranger, I could totally see someone who's going for a design first phone decision. This looks way better than the 50 in that regard. I think the camera section on the back looks better here. The finish is nicer. The display is more like refined. So yeah, it seems like a nice upgrade. The problem for us over here in the West is that I imagine they'll do what they did with the Honor 50 and we'll only get the base 60 and not the Pro. And the Pro is the one that I like.
Yeah, that's disappointing.
And it feels like a more meaningful upgrade because the other one is just using the same chip, same amount of RAM, a bit more RAM. It's like 8 gigabytes is the base, whereas the 50 had 6 gigabytes. But beyond that, yeah, it's very similar.
Maybe they'll just repackage the Pro as the 60. Because you know these companies don't care about branding, do they?
No, I'll take it. It's usually Oppo who confuses the names on their products internationally, and it gets really messy really quickly. But
it's hard to keep track. It is.
But yeah,
do we know? I mean, do we know like how much the 50 was when that came out?
I have some regional pricing for the 50. If I can find
it. Here we
are. The Honor 50 standard model. Bearing in mind, this started with 6 gigs of RAM versus 8, like I just said. The direct conversion from the Chinese pricing was £320, whereas the direct conversion from the Chinese pricing for the base 8 gig 128 on a 60, it's the same. It's the same.
Hey.
Same selling price. So it's 2,699 yen for the base on a 60 and the base on a 50. But the 60 comes with more RAM and an improved camera and a new, like, more up-to-date OS. But that's really it. Beyond that, it's kind of the same phone.
I don't think you can expect dramatic things for like a mid-ranger these days, because they, you know, they've played catch up so well over the last few years. I think, you know, rather than the high end being the exciting area of the phone market, it's the budget and it's the mid-range, because that's what's seen the most significant gains in performance, in battery life and camera performance since like 2015 or whatever. I think there's just so much that you can do, you know, when it comes to this, when you've got to squeeze in at the same price tag as, well, near the same price tag of what you, of the model you've already got.
Yeah,
you're kind of locked in without, you know, spending crazy amounts on R&D and retooling manufacturing processes and all the rest of it.
With that in mind, I was wondering whether this is more a case of them dealing with the chip shortage, of having enough of the 778.
Yeah.
And not being able to buy fancier chips, so they just thought they'd just tweak what they had already and serve it up again. It just seems
it may also be a chance, because I'm assuming that they probably have had some like brand damage after everything that happened, like with Huawei stuff. So, you know, just being able to like have another excuse to release something and to get their name out again and be like, hey, you know, we're back and all this. Because yeah, it's like, you know, a lot of people may still not know, and they may just think. Yeah,
I mean, I do. Like, my initial, whenever I hear about Honor, I'm like, oh, it's Huawei. And then I'm like, no, wait, not anymore.
Yeah.
To that point, though, Hannah, like, in China, where this was a non-issue, it was just, you know, it was just a business move. It didn't really affect the end user much. I think they're doing exceptionally well right now. I think they are number three, or they were number three pretty recently in terms of phone sales. So they've actually done better since, for whatever reason, even though I think they've lost access to a whole host of patents that Huawei has under like ownership of.
Huawei is very good at that. The patents, and especially the software patents on the kind of things that they implement into EMUI and stuff like that, like, and some of it's so good.
And also, I guess this also reflects that this still looks like a device that was definitely, the process for it was definitely kicked off whilst they were still one company, or still
100%
under the same
roof.
Yes. Yeah.
We're still yet to see a true new Honor device that is pure Honor engineering, design, software development, all under one roof.
I don't think that's going to happen for a couple of years yet, to be honest.
Potentially. Yeah. Although they do, I mean, they innovate quick. They do turn around devices pretty fast.
That's a good point, yeah.
So
And I'm comparing it to Apple, where I'm like, well, they knew that the iPhone 12 wasn't selling properly, but they still make the 13 mini because they were just so far along in that process already. So that's just what I just imagine that Honor's got like a whole year worth of Huawei designed phones coming before they can be like, right, we've cleared that off. Let's do our own thing now.
So yeah, we don't know when the Honor 60 or 60 Pro are heading further afield, but they're out now in China. You can check out all the details on techadvisor.com. And I think with that, that is everything that I want to talk about this week with you guys. So thank you so much for joining me, you two. Thank you everyone who's been watching the stream or listening at home. Don't forget to subscribe and leave us a review if you have enjoyed the podcast, the audio version of the podcast. And yeah, we'll be back next week. I don't know whether Dom's going to be back or whether he's just going to never come home. It's kind of hard to say at this point. We'll have to try and, I don't know, convince him with like turkey and Christmas crackers, but we'll have to wait and see.
I'll stay in Hawaii.
Exactly. I would train Hawaii personally, but there we go.
Okay, so Dom might or might not be back next week.
Thursday might also be... oh no, it's not next. I'm just losing. I'm mixing up the days now.
It's near the end of the year, Lewis.
Were you thinking it was Christmas party?
I was together, but yes, Christmas party will be soon too. Anyway, thank you so much, guys, for listening, and we will see you next week. Bye.
Bye, guys.